me to your heart. It makes me want to sing. It makes my spirit sing. Your grace, so I hear it call my name. I'm waking up to sing. I'm waking up to sing. Your cross, it draws me to your heart. It makes my spirit sing. It makes my spirit sing. Your grace, so I hear it call my name. I'm waking up to sing. I'm waking up to sing. We will sing and shout. We will sing and shout. Open up our hearts and pour your praises out. What could be better than a grace that washes all our shame away? What could be better than your great love? What could be better than a grace that leads us home and makes a way? What could be better than your great love? What could be better than a grace that washes all our shame away? What could be better than your great love? What could be better than a grace that washes away. What could be better than your great love? We will sing and shout, yeah, sing and shout. Open up our hearts and pour your praises out. We will sing and shout, we will sing and shout. Open up our hearts and pour your praises out. We will sing and shout, we will sing and shout. Open up our hearts and pour your praises out. We will sing and shout. We will sing and shout. Open up our hearts and pour your praises out. What could be better than a grace that washes all our shame away? What could be better than a grace?
Amen. Well, good morning. Welcome to worship here at St. Paul's. What a joy and a privilege it is to join you here in God's house of worship to thank and praise Him for all He's doing in our lives and all that we get to see Him do and accomplish through what Christ has done for us on the cross. And a special welcome to any guests that are joining us here this morning. We know that God has brought you here with us, and we treasure this moment to share this life of love with you. And we hope you'll experience that same joy that we have as we gather to worship our God this very morning. And we do have a gift for you if this is your first time visiting out in our fellowship area by our front entrance at our Welcome Center. Stop by and pick one of those up and join us in conversation about what God is doing in your lives as well. And a couple quick announcements before we begin this morning. One more to hit on what you should well know by now, that VBS is right around the corner starting tomorrow through Friday, the 15th to the 19th. I hope you came through the icy tunnel here as the kids get ready to make their way to Mount Everest in our Everest-themed VBS. It's going to be a great time, 9 to noon daily during the week. coming up this week. This will be for our three-year-olds all the way through our fourth graders. Registration is still open. If there are kids that you have or you know of that would want to be a part of this, there is still a chance to get them in, signed up and involved in that. And if you have already pre-registered, especially for you leaders out there, we do have t-shirts available for pickup right out in the fellowship area. Jen and her team are out there. So if you have pre-registered, your shirt is waiting for you. And just a quick word on some of the projects that our VBS will be benefiting as we go forward this week. They're all in your worship guide, but I just like to briefly say what those are, including we're going to be taking food items for the Decatur Kids Bags of Hope program. And this will be a neat time to benefit local children in our community. And the kids are going to be building these food pyramids throughout the week. They're going to be stacking all their team's proceeds that come in. And whoever has the highest pyramid, their leader is going to get to have like ice cold Mount Everest water dumped on them towards the end of VBS. That'll be a great time, a nice little incentive for the kids. And one of the other programs that we are partnering with is Lutheran World Relief, and all the work that they're doing, especially in Nepal, which is a very very much a part of where Everest is. So in light of the recent earthquakes and events, money will be going toward them to help recover and restore life in that area of the world. And if you want to find out how you can be involved in those mission opportunities with our VBS, you can also get that information out at our table in the fellowship area. And we have one more announcement here this morning, and this is going to come from Malcolm Head, who is one of our elders and is the chair for our next building campaign. And he's just going to tell us a little bit about where we're at and what's going on there, what God's up to and all that.
Thank you, Pastor Doug. Good morning.
Good morning.
So I want to thank you all for what God has been doing through all of you in this next campaign. And I also want to update you because our pledges are still coming in, and you know it's never too late to make a pledge when you seek God and ask Him what He wants you to do. But to date, we have 275 pledges for $2,813,728. This weekend officially starts the next giving for our Phase 2 build out. And in fact, I think we have it up here to date. We already have $210,608.90 already given for the next Phase 2 campaign. If you look at the back of your bulletins, there is instructions on how you can begin giving your next pledge. And we're not going to go through it, but just look at that. We encourage you to read this and begin. So I finally want to say that we are working diligently to bring together a revised plan based on our giving and our financing, and we will keep you informed. I will let you know that we have been approved by Church Extension Fund. Tentatively, it has to go to one more vote, but we have been given a approval for that, so that's a good sign, and we're going to go out and look forward to bringing you more information as we put things together. Thank you.
Thank you, Malcolm. And I know that the elders in the call and the building committee are working diligently to take all these pieces, try to fit it all together and how this is going to work out. And we know that God is going to do amazing things with this, that behind all these plans and all these build-outs, there's going to be more people that can hear this message that we're entrusted with. And how awesome is that we get a partner in this ministry that God has given to us. Well, we are here to worship this morning. We're talking about our schedules as we wrap up our Extreme Home Makeover series, talking about the things we do, the lives we have, how busy and not busy we are, and what we're doing with it all, and what God speaks to all that. So as we gather together to worship, let's stand and greet those worshiping with us this morning.
Good morning.
Morning.
We are so glad that you are here. But you know what's even better than us being here God is here. So we're going to hear from the Word of God. We've got the Sacrament of Communion, and He has promised to be with us in both of those. So in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, let's begin our worship. Our first song is Joyful.
Joyful, joyful.
Careful then how you live, not to be unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is.
This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, let us make the most of every opportunity and be wise, but not unwise. Let's make the most of the opportunity to praise God as we sing Hands to the Heavens.
We are your church. We are
gracious Heavenly Father, have your way in our lives. Help us to not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by renewing our minds to the likeness of your Son, Jesus Christ. That in all situations, in all things, we might see you in others. We might make the most of every opportunity you lay before us as we seek to reach out with the love of Christ to those that you have called us to see as Christ. God, we thank you for your mighty power that works through your Holy Spirit, that helps us to pattern our lives to what your will is. We pray for that Spirit now to rule and reign in our hearts as your word speaks to us. It's in your holy name we ask this. Amen. Congregation may be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. Amen. That word that engages us is from Ephesians chapter 5. Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. Well, this weekend we are wrapping up our current series of Extreme Home Makeover, and we've been discussing the many ways that God informs our daily living, the ways that we should live and act, and things regarding our marriages, our relationships, along with our finances, our parenting skills, and this very day the topic that lies before us is our schedules. The ways that we make and order our lives, what we plan out, what we'll do, and what we're about. And most importantly, behind it all, why we do what it is that we do. To head into our topic, we have one more video short that gathers around the Mize family dinner table. Let's take a look as they talk about their schedules.
So, Liv, what do we have on the schedule for today?
Well, I'm going to the church today to help Andrea with the mailing. Then I have to pick the boys up early from school and take them to the dentist.
And Dad, don't forget we have soccer practice today. And remember the balls this time. Last time everybody didn't have a ball and that didn't go out so well.
Jordan also has Taekwondo tonight and you have an elders meeting. So I guess we'll see each other at bedtime. And you should see what we have on the schedule for tomorrow.
This is crazy. How did life get so busy?
How did life get so busy? I think there are a good majority of us in the room that could echo those sentiments at least every once in a while. And I personally been in enough homes, I've seen enough things to know that when you have a big family or when you just have lives that get crazy, it takes some skill and effort to keep track of all the times and places that we commit ourselves to being at. Families have those whiteboard erasable calendars with the little magnetic strips, right, titled all different kinds of things so they can shift them to different days. And they're things like recital, practice, ball game, music lesson, meeting, homework, housework, and maybe if your parents are lucky, date night. In our world, it's not terribly hard to find ways to keep you and your family preoccupied. There are plenty of things for us to do in this culture and plenty of places to go. The difficult part, I submit, is knowing why it is we do what we do. If you had to evaluate all the different things in your life, all the different pieces of your schedule, to find out why it is you do what you do, how would that go? What do the different things that we do in our lives mean? Where are they taking us in life's journey? At times, in an effort not to miss out on anything, we can sign ourselves up for just about everything and then get caught up trying to keep up with that pace of life that we've set for ourselves. It's not always as important as to what it is we're doing so long as we're just busy doing something. We need that next TV show on Netflix to get sucked into. As soon as one sport we love ends, the next one picks right up. Our jobs and our careers can take over, limiting time for anything else that we care about in life. Coffee, for many of us, becomes the daily fuel. Long nights become the expectation, while meaningful conversations and relationships with those we love wither and can fall by the wayside. We can't do it all, and we know that, but it doesn't stop us from trying. And with our baggy eyes and our booked up lives, we can start to wear our busyness as a sort of badge. We can start getting in conversations where we tell people just how stressed out and tired we are, but really behind that, we are a little proud of the things we do, the ways that we're involved, the ways that we matter to this world. It helps us to feel important. It helps us to feel in control. It's not that all of our commitments that we make are in themselves bad things, but what can end up happening is that these things can stand in the way of what matters the most. It's interesting to note that in our Ephesians reading, it's not really necessarily about how much we do, but really how we're doing it. Paul says that we should be careful how we live, making the most of every opportunity. Whatever God puts in front of us, be fully there. Squeeze out every ounce of meaning and impact in any event or situation, and don't miss out on what God could be doing right in front of us, as He could be using any of us at any given time to reach out to others in a most powerful way for His kingdom purpose. In our gospel reading, Jesus gives us a parable about schedules, pride, and a great banquet feast. And this will be the basis for the rest of our message. And I'd invite you to open up a Bible to Luke chapter 14, verses 15 to 24 will be our focus text. You can use a pew Bible in front of you, or if you have electronic devices with Bibles on them. We're going to look at this parable in the surrounding context and see how Jesus addressed the busyness of life that he encountered. And here in our reading, Jesus tells this parable story that describes a party being prepared by a heavenly host for some of his guests, but those invited had other things going on. The actual scene starts out with what seems to be this great statement. Someone dining with Jesus says this: "Blessed is the man who will eat at the feast of the kingdom of God." Now that sounds pretty good, right? I mean, I could say amen to that. Anyone feasting with God is truly a blessed person. But I want to take a moment and have us look at the setting behind this passage. Because if we back up to verse 1, we find out just who Jesus was dining with and just what was meant by that phrase. Verse 1 says, "One Sabbath, when Jesus went to eat in the house of a prominent Pharisee, he was being carefully watched." Here Jesus was in the house of not just any ordinary Pharisee, but really he was with the bigwigs. Okay, these were the top dogs, and they invited Jesus to dinner to judge and critically analyze his every move. They wanted to see if Jesus could measure up to all that hype, that publicity that the crowds had been giving him as he went around to heal people and help restore people's needs. And so now Jesus sat, and you could probably imagine this dinner table, however it looked, Jesus being on one side, all these other Pharisees on the other. It was more like a panel of judges from American Idol, except these guys would put Simon Cowell to shame by the way they judged. First, the waters get tested when Jesus notices a man with a health condition. In our text, it's called dropsy. And this is where your body collected fluid, and they couldn't identify the problem of this ailment. The man's body was collecting fluid, and he could have been the servant of this prominent Pharisee. We don't know. He could have been planted there by these religious leaders to see how Jesus would react. So Jesus asks the Pharisees, "Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath?" Well, these Pharisees know better than to just open themselves up to criticism and judgment, so they stayed quiet. Only Jesus wasn't trying to trap them. His question was sincere. And to show his sincerity, he answered his own question with or without them by healing the man and then sending him on his way. You see, the Pharisees didn't care about that sick man. He was just part of their agenda, a chance to trap Jesus and catch him doing something that would have been unlawful by the rules that they had created by what God had commanded. But Jesus demonstrated that the whole point of the Sabbath is that sick man. The whole point of the Sabbath is to do good while resting in God's goodness. He tried to challenge these Pharisees to see that by getting them to admit that if they had something they loved, that they would reach out. If something was in danger or trouble, even on the Sabbath, they would go to that thing that they valued, and they would reach out and rescue. They would put down their strict, holy schedules to run to what was most important to them. And then the greater challenge that Jesus gives rests in the truth that God wants those Pharisees and all people to put down our agendas and rush to the aid of all people, even beyond those that we hold near and dear to us. The one in need, Jesus says, should matter the most. In verse 7, Jesus notices that all these higher-up Pharisees have taken their own seats of honor around the dinner table. So Jesus does what he does. He steps over the ropes to join them in the VIP lounge and told them this: when someone offers you a place of honor, give it up. Don't think that you might be the most important person in the room. Instead, take the lowliest place. That way, if the host notices, he'll be the one to honor you and raise you up. Jesus went on to say, everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but he who humbles himself will be exalted. Jesus goes on to tell them that there's really no blessing in simply providing for your wealthy Pharisee friends. You know they're just going to scratch your back. They'll repay the favor. Once you have them over, they'll have you right back over. There's no service or sacrifice in it. So Jesus tells them, if you want to serve, give to those who truly need it. Have a feast for those that will truly be benefited, the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind. They cannot return the favor, and therein lies the blessing. The reward for you won't be an earthly one. The reward for you will be in heaven. Now, you would think at this point, before our gospel reading, that these Pharisees would have a lot to digest. I mean, Jesus has challenged their view of the purpose and meaning behind the Sabbath. He's called out their prideful attitudes and the way they saw themselves as such high achievers and prominent people. And he's asked them to use their powers and authorities to bless those who don't have it. Jesus here is meddling with their authority, their scheduled activities, their way of living. So what's the response to all this? Well, we make our way back to verse 15. One of these Pharisees raises his glass and says to Jesus in response, "Blessed is the man who will eat at the feast of the kingdom of God." Are you starting to catch the tone of this Pharisee's holy statement? You see, this man wasn't concerned at all with anything that Jesus had just got done saying. He wasn't worried about the poor, the crippled, or the needy. He's not going to change a thing that he does. When he says, "Blessed is the man," you can be sure that he inserted his name along with all his righteous friends around that dinner table. "Oh, I'm sorry, Jesus. I do feel bad for those people who are out there suffering. But you know what? They're out there, and there's a reason they're out there, and we're in here because we've arrived. We've made it. We're on the inside track with God. And you know what? Blessed is the man." This was not a God-honoring statement. This was a self-honoring statement. And whatever empire this man had built up in his life, whatever clubhouse he thought he belonged to, it was enough to convince him that he had earned himself a reservation at God's eternal feast. So then we make our way to our gospel reading. And here Jesus gives one more shot at reaching these immaculate leaders with the truth that God is not impressed with how busy and important we think we are. Jesus tells them this story about how his gospel works. He gives the parable of the great banquet, Luke 14, 16 to 24. Jesus replied, "A certain man was preparing a great banquet and invited many guests. At the time of the banquet, he sent his servant to tell those who had been invited, 'Come, for everything is now ready.' But they all alike began to make excuses. The first said, "I have just bought a field and I must go and see it. Please excuse me." Another said, "I have just bought 5 yoke of oxen and I'm on my way to try them out. Please excuse me." Still another said, "I just got married, so I can't come." The servant came back and reported this to his master. Then the owner of the house became angry and ordered his servant, "Go out quickly into the streets and alleys of the town and bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame." "Sir," the servant said, "what you ordered has been done, but there is still room." Then the master told his servant, "Go out to the roads and country lanes and compel them to come in, so that my house will be full." Jesus said, "I tell you, not one of those who were invited will get a taste of my banquet." Jesus took the self-centeredness of the Pharisee and turned it upside down. Those blessed men at the heavenly feast might not have been who they thought they were. Jesus said, "They are the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame. They're the ones who matter most to God." And you know, the most ironic thing about those religious leaders is they were so caught up in the busyness of their lives, their rule following, and their doing, trying to make their way to God and earn themselves a seat at God's holy banquet, that they didn't even realize that God's feast was sitting right in front of them. God's spotless lamb, the Savior of the world, right before their very eyes, and they were too self-absorbed to even notice. They had so much going on, too many reasons, too many excuses to have time to care about what this Jesus of Nazareth was saying and doing, and let alone to care about some common man and his common illness. They were missing out on what God was putting right in front of them. Just a few days ago, I went to see one of the members of our church. Her name is Robin Reaver, and Robin is a name that many of you might know personally, and even if you don't, you might recognize that name. You probably should, because we've been praying for Robin for over a year now in our worship services. And Robin is actually suffering from a very similar ailment that our person in the text had, this dropsy, this collecting of fluid. And the doctors can't figure out why it's happening. And Robin's had moments where it looks like things are getting better, but then recently she's relapsed, and now she's back from doing rehabilitation to being back in the hospital. And I was on my way to see Robin at St. Mary's, and as I was making my way in, I got to confess, I was walking up to the hospital room and the busyness of my life started to take over and my mind was elsewhere. I started thinking about all the things that I had to get done. It was a Friday night. I needed to get home and take the dog out and get ready for the weekend services and get dinner ready for Michelle if she was working. And I was busy thinking about all the things that I needed to go and do. And when I got up to Robin's room, I was so humbled at what was taking place in front of me. Because here is a woman who started to pour her heart out to me, and a woman whose spirit has been tested for months and months and months, and she started to break down and cry and ask me, "Why would God be doing this? Why is this taking so long? We've tried and we've tried, and it seems like things are getting better, but as soon as they do, things just get worse, and I don't know why God is having me go through all of this." My heart was breaking. My stomach was turning because there I was just minutes before thinking about all the things that I was going to get and do at my home. And here's this woman who hasn't seen the inside of her home in over 6 months. It was a humbling thing. And I realized that what God was saying through this gospel text was so applicable to that moment, that here Robin is. And here Christ says that right now Robin is the most important person in that room. And I told her, "Robin, I don't know why you're going through all this. I can't tell you why it's taking so long and why the doctors can't figure out what's happening, but I do know this, that to God, you are what matters most. And Robin, I want you to know that you are the most important part of my day right now as I come to see you. You are what matters most. And I know that God is putting me here to be that living reminder of his love for you. It was a humbling thing. And I almost missed out on what God was doing right in front of me because of the busyness of my own life. You see, those religious leaders were trying to do so much, but in reality, they were missing out on everything that mattered. And that was the way of the Pharisee. But I don't want to be like that. I want to be like the way of Jesus. And you know what's fascinating about the way of Jesus? It's that for Jesus, no one was ever an interruption, and Jesus was never in a hurry. Pastor Ray challenged us during the week with that. I dare you to go through the gospel and find a time when Jesus was in a hurry. Sure, there were abrupt circumstances in Jesus' life, many deviations from the path that he was walking on earth, but every encounter provided a unique opportunity to reach out and serve in his Father's kingdom. Earlier this week on staff, we were marveling at all the situations where Jesus broke from the daily routine to reach out to others. When his disciples brought before him little children, they tried to shoo them away, and Jesus said, "Let them come to me, for theirs is the kingdom of God." When Jesus was right in the middle of a speaking engagement, he was giving a sermon in someone's house, and there was a great crowd gathered around him. Someone was lowered from the roof to be healed. And it's not like Jesus put him aside to say, "Hold on, I got to finish this message." And you know, I've thought about that. What if someone came right down from the skylight here at St. Paul's? What would that do to our worship service? How would I react to that? But Jesus didn't put him on pause. He stopped, went right up to that man, healed him of his illness, and did even more than that. He forgave him his sins. On the way to restore the daughter of Jairus, a synagogue ruler, Jesus stopped along the way for a woman who had been suffering severe bleeding for years. Jesus paused to take care of her in that moment, and in that moment, this man's daughter ended up dying. But even this break in the day was just another chance for Jesus to show God's mission and power. As Jesus continued on, he made his way to Jairus' home, knelt before that little girl, and said, "Talitha kum, I say to you, get up and rise." And he brought her back to life. For Jesus, it was never about some high agenda. It was about every person that he encountered on the way to his final destination, to the cross. Hebrews 12 says that we are to fix our eyes on Jesus, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. The cross was not just a place and a time for Jesus to be. It was Christ's opportunity to seize forgiveness and life for all of us. That was the joy that God had set before him, which he endured and suffered and was shamed for. Christ didn't see dead pieces of wood on Calvary's hill. No, he saw you and he saw me. He saw living lives and souls that were worth dying for. It's no small task for us to figure out exactly what we're supposed to do with our lives. And sometimes I know, if you're like me, I just wish God would write it in the sky what it is he wants us to do. Give me the field guide, the manual for my life, and what you want me to do. And there are many things that we commit and sign ourselves up for. And like those Pharisees, we can so easily lose sight of the meaning behind it all. Why it is we do what we do. We too can get wrapped up in the prestige of being a doer. And certainly God wants us to be a doer. He wants us to commit our lives to noble cause and activities. But we can never let these events cloud what is most important, the people and opportunities that they're all about, that God is putting right in front of us. God wants us to be about what matters the most, reaching out to others that need him most with his love. So ask yourselves this: in all my scheduled events and activities, How can I embody the love that God has given me through His Son, Jesus Christ? How can I surrender my life to God's will so that in any circumstance, I can make the most of every opportunity, even and especially in the unscheduled and unplanned interruptions? You know, God's schedule might not look like ours, and oftentimes it doesn't. Are we still willing to trust that powerful word from Jeremiah 29:11? That when we make our lives, we plan it all out, there'll come a place where God says to us, I know the plans I have for you. And they will be plans to prosper you and not to harm you, to give you a hope and a future in both the good times as well as the bad times. Our hope is secured in Christ. He gave us His life, and He's opened up that banquet table to every person that would call Him their Savior. So may our lives continue to further this work and mission, that everything we're about, every event we go to is about a person, and every person matters to God. May our schedules, our busyness demonstrate that same love of God that's always been about people. Through Jesus Christ, and in Him we ask this. Amen. And now may the peace that passes all understanding guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen. And now we come to God with our tithes and our offerings, a chance for us to respond to this great love of God, to bless the lives of others, real people with real needs. And as the ushers come forward, they will collect the tithes and the offerings, and they will also gather the worship cards, which are located in the pews in front of you for our guests and our members. Fill those out, pass those to the center aisle. And if you are a guest worshiping with us, this is a chance for us to respond to God's love. There is no expectation that you would give. Your presence among us is your gift to God this day.
Thank you.
now we enter into a time of confession and forgiveness with our God, a time when we take a good hard look at ourselves, we stare into the face of God's mirror that is His law to see how we've measured up, to come back wanting, knowing that there are things we cannot provide to ourselves, and that is right where God wants us, that is right where His gospel meets us. And I suppose this will be another personal confession of mine, that it seems like the places that I look forward to the most in my life when I think about my busy schedule is that moment when I can just get back home and get to that easy chair and just relax for a little bit. Sometimes that's the fuel that keeps us going. And I was convicted the other day as I was thinking about that, that while I do look forward to that moment so much, that really is the moment I have the least impact in this world. It's a moment that's really just about me being recharged and rejuvenated, and certainly we need that. But God also wants us to make the most of every opportunity that He is putting in front of us. And so if you have looked at your lives and you think about all the ways that we do fall short of living as God wants us to, and we do things that go contrary to what God wants us to, His good and pleasing will, I ask that you would join me in this prayer of confession as we lay our lives before our Savior. We pray. Dear Father, we humbly confess that far too often we become the center of our own worlds. Our schedules can end up getting in the way of what matters most, the people you have given us to love. We believe in Jesus and His model of loving others, but in our pride and our busyness, we miss the chance to share this love with others. Forgive this and all our sins because of what your Son has done for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks be to God that He has never missed an opportunity. He sent His one and only Son, Jesus Christ, into this world that He would live a perfect life for us. He would conquer all our laziness, all our inability to do good for Him. And He would carry all our sins to that cross, where it would be paid for once and for all. It is this powerful grace of our God through Jesus Christ that I can proclaim to you this day that all our sins are forgiven in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And so that we would know this grace and forgiveness, that it would be made real to us in our lives, Christ gave us His own body and blood into death so that we could live. And so we stand as we remember Jesus bringing us these powerful words of promise. We remember that our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when He was betrayed, took bread. And when He had given thanks, He broke it and gave it to His disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, He took the cup after supper, and when He had given thanks, He gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." If this is your solemn confession and vow that Jesus Christ is your true Lord and Savior who gave His true and very own body and blood into death for you, for the forgiveness of all our sins of which we are so desperately in need of as sinners. And once you receive this gift, we will go out to live lives worthy of this calling. And welcome to the Lord's table. Our ushers and communion assistants will dismiss you by rows to the front in four rows. And you may be seated at this time, and I invite them forward.
Lies beyond the stars, those dazzling
now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in body and soul unto life everlasting. Depart in that peace. Amen. At this time, we continue with our prayers for our faith family here at St. Paul's and for all the prayers that are on our hearts and minds, our opportunity to talk with our Heavenly Father, to lift up our needs and concerns, knowing that He hears us and cares for us. And we especially remember to pray for those who are in need of healing at this time, those who matter to God. They matter most in their need, in their critical hour. And so we pray for Vicki Pickerel, who is continuing her rehab at St. Mary's, asking God to give her daily strength, her daily bread, so that she can get through the physical training she needs to get back home. And for Ken Roberson, who is the father of Andrea Aubert, members here in our service this day, asking that God would be near them and near Ken as he battles his ailments, and just asking for peace of mind and comfort and hope in the life that God has given to him. And we continue to lift up Robin Reaver in our prayers, asking that God would just renew her spirit, that He would make His presence known and real to her, that she would trust in that promise that God is with her. He knows her plans, and He will take care of her. We also pray for John Kretzinger, who is hospitalized in Austria and is actually having surgery done today on a collapsed lung, asking that God would be with the doctors and nurses to heal him and give them safe passage back home here to Decatur. And for Rudy Letrick and Rick Harmon as they battle cancer, and for Tom Mitchell, who is a friend of Dave and Rhonda Purcell's, as he nears the end of his life battling cancer, asking God to be in all their struggles, as we know He is through Christ, carrying all our burdens upon Himself. And we also just ask God to continue to be with our congregation as we seek His leadership and His guidance among us for all our leadership questions, our building questions, that God would just lay our plans out before us and that we would just follow in step with Him. And everything that we do would just be an honor to Him, knowing what He has asked us to do for His mission and His kingdom. And we also pray for our VBS, that the lives of those little ones coming here would just be greatly impacted and filled with joy and life and love, and that they would go back to their homes and fill their families with the love of Christ that they experience here. And for all the volunteers and leaders who have put so much time and effort into this, pray that God would just bless those efforts. We stand for prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come before You again yet today, Lord, to give thanks to You, the God that we have through You and through Your Son, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit who pours out this knowledge of You into our hearts. And God, we thank You for Your Son who lived a life among us, seizing every opportunity that He came into contact with, that nothing was ever an interruption for Him, Lord. We ask for that same spirit among us as we seek to live lives worthy of this calling that You have brought us into through Your Son, asking that everything we do would just be a testimony to the God that You are, that we would be Your salt and light in this world, a shining beacon to the hope that this world has through the resurrection of Your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we now ask that You would be with all those who are hurting, those who are struggling, Lord, in diseases and illnesses of this world. We ask that You would be the God that is bigger than all our troubles, that we would cast all our anxieties upon You because You do care for us. Lord, enable us to care for one another the way that Your Son has first cared for us. And Lord, we also ask that You would be near our church, that You would hold all our plans in Your hands, and that we would faithfully follow You to that place that You already are. We ask for Your patience and Your peace as You establish our plans and our paths. Lord, we also bring before You our VBS, knowing that this will be a great time to honor You as we come before Your word and just celebrate the gift of life that You've given to us. We pray blessings upon all that we do, and may all that we say and all that we're about just be a testimony to the God that we have in You, a God who conquers all heights and depths, who can spread love through every mountain, peak, and pass to reach our hearts. We thank You for that, Lord. And now we give You all our prayers, those that we have spoken and those still on our hearts and minds, as we join together in the prayer that Your Son has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now receive the blessing of our God. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. We join together in our closing song. Worship team, for all your leading us this morning, and especially to you, Kyle, for leading us through here in the absence of Heidi. Thank you so much. And thanks to all of you for being here to worship our God and to prepare to go out into his worlds to make a difference and make the most of every opportunity. And before you go, we have one quick reminder here of VBS things that are happening right after church. So before you escape through the ice tunnel, Jen has some words about VBS.
So in case you haven't caught on, Vacation Bible School is starting here tomorrow. And I just have to say that I have been absolutely amazed at the amount of people who have come forward to help with Vacation Bible School in big and small ways. And if I could ask for just one more thing before you go today, if you have a few minutes to help clear out these front chairs, we're going to bring them into the warehouse and help move some of these awesome decorations that Brenda and her team have made in here, that would be a huge blessing to us. If you could just come forward after the service, that would be great. And as Linda staff has probably said to me 100 times in the past month, happy VBS.
Thank you so much, Jen. Amen. And here we go, VBS 2015. Will God be with you in your days and your weeks ahead, and may His word be that encouragement, that blessing in our lives. God bless.